So I want to talk a little bit about geological time. Now I know this looks a lot like a glass of beer rather than geological time, but it's an important thing for context. So we have this beautiful mural up here along the wall, which shows the sort of important features of life from a human perspective. So the last little bit, when the mastodon comes, takes up fully one third of the mural, which is perfectly appropriate. It's like a map. You've got to see what's important for what you're trying to communicate. But in real time, that blue part with the mastodon doesn't even fill the very top line that corresponds to the glow on the lip of the glass of beer. And that glass of beer only corresponds in time to the time when there were multicellular creatures on Earth, and that is only a little bit of time of the age of the Earth. So if you had the time that's represented by that blue thing in this diagram, you could not see it. So the time period that I'm going to talk about is much older than the time that humans are around, hundreds of millions of years older, 200 million years ago, in the middle of the beer glass. So that's the interval of time that I want to talk about. A lot of things are happening there, and that's where you see the part that's in green, the Mesozoic era, particularly continents drift creating the Watchung Ridge. So 200 million years ago, all the continents were united in the supercontinent of Pangaea. Geography couldn't have been simpler. You could walk from Brisbane to Vladivostok if you were an ambitious animal. The area we're in here in the Watchung was in fact that yellow dot in the tropics. The equator was right down here. It's about 20 degrees north latitude, so it was a completely different environment than it was than it is now, and it was right in the middle of this supercontinent, with one continent and one giant ocean. And if we look at it with the outlines of the continents today upon the supercontinent of Pangaea, we're located right there. So, as North America began to pull apart, it says there, continents drift. North America went this way, South America went this way. The crust was stretched, the crust broke, huge chunks of land subsided and filled with mud and silt from the surrounding mountains. The remnants of that fill of those big holes that formed as North America and Africa drifted apart are preserved today in eastern North America where these black blobs are. And this one in particular is called the Newark Basin. Now, one of the great things about the Watchung Reservation is the topography. I mean, I'm sure all of you have walked around here and enjoyed the hills and the valleys and so forth. And I want to put that in context for you because you are seeing, as you walk up and down these hills, the results of what was happening 200 million years ago in the Newark Basin. So here's a map of part of eastern North America. Here's New York and Manhattan. We are located in the red box right here. Here's Route 78. There's Plainfield, and that, of course, is Pennsylvania over there, and New Jersey over here. And let's take a look at the topography shown as a grayscale image superimposed on the geography. So here are the Watchung ridges. Now let's clean this up by getting rid of all this human culture and look at just the raw topography. So now you're just seeing the hills and valleys. And here are the first and second Watchung Mountains. That's the third. We're, of course, located right on this ridge right there. So let's focus in on that a little bit. Let's put this now, let's superimpose the geology. And if you could strip all the soil away and all the human activity and just see the rocks that are under the soil, you would see this map. And now I'm going to remove the topography and just look at the geology. And it turns out that these ridges are underlain by these things, which are lava flows, gigantic lava flows. And you will not believe how big these things really were. You know, you live in a region like this just like I did. And I came here when I was 17, you know, found fossils. And you know, it seems like a kind of normal place. And you don't realize the gigantic, enormous things that transpire to make things the way they are. So we're going to focus in on that area a little bit. Just zoom in on that box. And here's the topography again. Just the topography. So this is the first Watchung Mountain. You can make out, in fact, the loop road. and back here in the topography. This is called the LIDAR image. This is a radar from satellites. What's this? That's Route 78, that's correct. What's this? That's the quarry, that's correct. Absolutely. So we are right now located in this building, which shows up right here in the radar image. This is what's called Washington Valley, and it wraps around this way towards Martinsville and over the Plaquemine. This is the second Watchung Ridge. And now let's take a look at laying the geology on top of the topography. So now you see these pink layers. These are layers of rock that are hardened lava that are tilting in this way. And they're ridges because the lava is much harder than what's around it, which is in the valley, which are sedimentary rocks that were deposited in streams and rivers and especially lakes, and that's where we get all the fossils. We don't get the fossils from the lava flows. When we put the map of the Watchung Reservation on top of this, we are located right here at Trailside, and there are all these wonderful trails to walk in. So when you go down in the valley and you're in the valley of Blue Brook, that sedimentary rocks that are in that valley are called the Feltville Formation, which I named in 1980 after, guess where? The old village of Feltville. This is Orange Mountain. This is the Orange Mountain Basalt. It's named after Orange Mountain in Orange. This is the Preakness to Basalt. This continues a ridge all the way up into further northern New Jersey, where the Preakness Mountain is, and it's named after that. And this is the Tuwaka Formation, which is another sedimentary rock that's named after the village of Tuwaka. So we're just going to talk about what's right here. There we are. Here's the quarry. Now the quarry is there because the lava is very hard. The lava, when crushed, makes a quite valuable material called road metal. In mixed with asphalt, that makes macadam. And almost every bit of macadam in this entire region is made out of rock of that type, hardened lava from quarries like that. It also goes into concrete. It also, in big blocks, makes riprap. And the creeks that were eroding, the small tributaries to Blue Brook that were eroding, that were riprap because when the roads became more active, there was too much runoff and erosion was going crazy, the riprap that's in those creeks is from those quarries as well. So let's take a look at that quarry. So we're up here, right? We're looking slightly, we're only looking due north. You can see a lot layer of lava right here at the northwest end of the quarry, and there are layers of lava inside the quarry, and these are big hills of crushed lava. And then in the valley here, 78, that's 78 back here, the valley is full of sediments that are lying on top of this lava flow. This lava flow turns out to be really important in the history of life. Not just the history of New Jersey, the history of all life on Earth, because it belongs to part of this blob, the big red blob that occupied central Pangaea. That lava flow is part of the largest lava flow formation we know on the planet. It's called the Central Atlantic Magmatic Province, and it's called that because the Central Atlantic formed right in the middle of it, and it probably was part of the process that made the continents drift apart, and there were gigantic eruptions. How big is that? It's 11 million square miles. Now that sounds like a lot. How big is that? That's one-third the area of the moon. It's larger than the United States. That's how big that is. So that's one of the largest series of eruptions on Earth that's ever happened. And do you think that might have been a little bit disruptive? It was. And at the time that occurred, about half of all life forms on Earth were wiped out by the indirect consequences of that lava flow. Not by the lava flow rolling over the dinosaurs or anything like that. Instead, it was gases from the lava flow, and I'll talk a little bit about that in a couple of minutes. But let's talk about Feltville and Watchung Reservation again. So here we're back at the map. We're going to look at this region right here, including the old village of Feltville. Now, when I was in high school and I got interested in all this stuff, especially about finding the fossils and the context, I first was introduced by very kind colleagues at various museums, including this guy right here, to libraries that institutions had. And these libraries let me read about the fossil history of this region, but also the very old geological survey bulletins that were written in the 19th century. And they talked about important quarries along Washington Valley that produced limestone. And the limestone was used for making cement because in the 19th century, transportation was seriously expensive. So if you could find even horrible sources of limestone, just little layers like this, you could produce cement out of it and save some money, and it was a resource. So there were a series of quarries, and those quarries produced fossil fish, which I learned about. There were also copper mines, and some of the copper mines produced fossil fish out of the same limestone layers. Now here's a colleague of mine, just the village of Feltville is up the hill here, and this is along a trail, and there are layers of limestone. And in 1973, I found some fossil fish in them, some of which are on display here. And to get them, I had to excavate. Don't try this at home, don't try this here anymore. And those two fossil fish came out of this. And that was 1973. When I did that. And there's some communication between the Union County Park Commission and myself during that time. This is one of the fossil fish. This is the broken one that's on exhibit. I had glued it together with an inappropriate glue, which eventually disintegrated. Now that doesn't look too good, but the same valley in other places produces fossil fish that look like this. That's from near Martinsville. That's not bad, right? If you can actually take the fish heads or any part of the body, actually remove them from the rock and get extraordinary detail. Here's the eye, here's the mouth. This fossil from here to here is this big. And if we zoom in on the mouth, you can see the teeth. So this is like looking at like a dead fish. Look at all the details of the anatomy in these fish. Now this fish turned out to be very interesting. In their own respect. This is a reconstruction of one that I published in 1991. I don't know why this says 1980, because it isn't. This fish turns out to have done extraordinary things in the lakes that occupied the valleys that formed as North America and Africa pulled apart. They evolved into what are called species flocks, hundreds of species of closer related fish with all kinds of funny shapes and little ornaments on the back and so forth, almost identical to the fish that live today called cichlids in the rift lakes of East Africa and in the Amazon. Who here has an aquarium with cichlids? Anybody? Yeah? What kind?
Discus.
Discus, right. Well, discus is a South American cichlid. There are species flocks in the Amazon, and that's where discus is from. But other cichlids live in the African Great Lakes, and there are hundreds of species. They're all very, very closely related, but having different shapes and different colors. And it turns out that this particular fish is almost directly related to the ancestry of a living group of fish, which we didn't really know about until very recently. That group of fish are these. Which, anybody know what the kind of fish these are? They're alive in the Mississippi drainage system today. Although these are actually fossils, but this type is alive today. These are gars, and they can get very, very large, and they're descended from this kind of fish, which we find right here in Feltville. And here's an example of a not-so-living one, but at least it used to be living relatively recently. You can see this gentleman here worked for the Field Museum of Natural History in Chicago, and I think they were both stuffed at the same time. That's a big fish, but that's a living gar. And it has scales identical to the kind that you find on the fossil fish right here. So you see these rectangular scales? You'll see exactly the same kind of scales on the fossils here. So now let's look at another spot, a ravine. It's right down here. And at that spot, we found this. This is on exhibit over there as well. What is this? The foot. What kind of foot? Good, a bird. That's good. That's very good. A bird. Well, birds belong to the group that this was produced by. That group are dinosaurs. Birds directly inherit the three-toed foot from carnivorous dinosaurs. It says right up there, first birds and mammals, Archaeopteryx, extinct. The three-toed foot of a chicken comes from a dinosaur. And this is the imprint of course, a much larger dinosaur than the Archaeopteryx, and it has the characteristic shape of a carnivorous dinosaur footprint. But there's much more to it than just that. First thing is that if you look at the other side of this fossil, you see that even though the rock's this thick, and you can see that for yourself there, there's a hole on the other side where this dinosaur stepped into deep mud, foot pushed through, spread out, and then pulled up again, and the mud collapsed on the foot, just like what happened to you if you're walking in mud. That footprint was produced by an animal like this, shown here with feathers. This is Dilophosaurus, and this was the kind of dinosaur that made that footprint 200 million years ago. And it is a survivor of the mass extinction that was caused by those lava flows. So here are the kind of creatures that were around before that. Here are the kind of creatures that are around after it. Once the lava flow did its nasty business killing off these guys, the dinosaurs took over, and from 200 million years to 65 million years, the non-bird dinosaurs ruled the Earth. Here's an example of a footprint from New Jersey of the kind of animal that was a competitor to dinosaurs that was wiped out. And here's a large dinosaur footprint from Clifton. That's one of the survivors, the same kind of footprint we have on display here, although a better quality one because this one didn't stick its foot in really deep mud. So let's take a look at the process by which this would actually occur. This is, I'm going to show you a short animation by a scientist at Brown University, which shows a foot going deep into the mud and then withdrawing. And it makes a funny shape on the way out as the mud collapses back in. So when you look at this block, you see something else. You see this. What do you think that might be? Now you know why this looks like it's poking out at you? Because it is, right? This is the mud, this is the silt that was on top of the mud. The dinosaur's foot passed all the way through the layer to this surface. So you're looking at it upside down. That's a stem that was buried by the event that laid down that silt. And if you go to the other side of the stem, you find this, and that's a fern fossil. And this site produces some of the finest fern fossils in these age rocks in North America. Here's another example, and one of the things you can see here is that it's snaking its way through the rock, and that's because that fern was not buried as a leaf. The whole plant was knocked down in the event of being buried, and it's still attached to its stem. Very, very tough leaves. Now, in other places down here in the valley, you find little shoots, little twigs of conifers with little tiny leaves, and they're extremely common as well. And they were produced by a plant that could survive under the conditions that these lava flows produced in the environment. Now, when the lava flow erupted, you don't just get lava. You get gases. Now, if you happen to be a place where those gases come out and they collect, it will kill you. Because one of the main gases that comes out is carbon dioxide. Carbon dioxide is a trace gas in the atmosphere right now, but we all know about carbon dioxide, right? Because what are we worried about with carbon dioxide coming from the burning of fossil fuels? Greenhouse conditions, global warming. Well, when that first Huachung lava came out, so much carbon dioxide was put into the atmosphere in a very short period of time that it actually doubled the amount of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere in a period of less than 100 years. Except at the time, the carbon dioxide levels weren't at 390 like they are now. They were at over 1,000 parts per million. And they went up to 2,000 to 6,000 parts per million in 100 years. And these are rock cores from not too far from here that have little nodules of limestone. And those nodules let you read the amount of calcium, read the amount of carbon dioxide within the air. And that's how we know it actually happened. And it was that carbon dioxide and super greenhouse warming that caused the mass extinction. So let's look at one more place. Where's this? Route 78. So this produces crystals that allow us to date these rocks precisely. These crystals tell us that that lava flow on Route 78 is 201.282 plus or minus 0.031 million years. How much is 0.031 million in normal years? 31,000 years. That's the precision out of 200 million which we can date that rock. So we know an enormous amount about these rocks. We know an enormous amount about these lavas. We know it caused a mass extinction. We know it caused the dinosaurs to take over the world. And that's all I have to say. Thank you.